Greetings, Earthlings. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 153. And we're going back to Dayton to look at a couple of folks who make stuff. Hardened Power Systems and TiltPlate. TiltPlate's not the total name of the company. I'm not even sure there is a total name of the company. Well, you'll see what they've got. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Behind me is Arvin, Chief Financial Officer, reminding you to stop by hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy the program, you don't know if you enjoy this program yet because you haven't really seen it. Let's see. I'm going to put some inside information about how we're doing, how the podcast is doing at the end of the program. You've been listening to the viewers that say, get to the program material and stop the fluff at the beginning. So we'll put the inside stuff toward the end, but I do have a couple things that I need to do first besides point you to Arvin. Let's see. I got the radios turned off. We got a little bit too much lightning activity coming. We are here. That stuff is there. It'll be here sooner than I like. The other thing that I want to check out is, this down here. This black box here. Somebody that I know, I didn't know him real well, but somebody that gave me a lot of help when I was getting Ham Radio Now started is Tom Samasico, KB4HQA. He did the HQA radio podcast, and I was watching Ham Nation last week, and George announced the sad news that Tom had passed away. And again, I was saying that he did a lot to help me get this thing started. As I was struggling to figure out the best way to do live switching and get stuff into the computer, and I was recording everything on three cameras, rolling a lot of videotape right here in the studio, and that didn't make any sense. So he pointed me to this Wirecast system that I'm using here. This here Wirecast. And a lot of other technical advice in the background. Tom did his last program. Looks like it was, well, he did a lot of programs. He was very ambitious. D-Star Show, Weekly Show, Digital Modes, did some specials. But his signature program was this Sunday Live Show, which he actually did live, something that I have not attempted to do yet. To do something in real time. Mostly when I book guests or do other things, there's a lot of production involved, and doing it live would be difficult. Although I do kind of want to do some live programs, like the one with Bill, the previous episode, the Friday night BS. It'll be fun to do those live. I'm not sure why. I guess just because live is more fun than recorded. But this is being recorded, so yeah, this is another recorded program. Tom managed to do his programs live. One of the things that Tom had the ability to, the technical background to do all these things. I wish I could have hired Tom as my engineer to put more of my program together and do some of the background stuff. Doing it all by myself, even with advice from guys like Tom, it's taking too long to make improvements. I want to show you a little bit of Tom's last show. You hear him get things started, clunking around. He had the technical ability to do this stuff. He never pretended that he was a real serious broadcaster type. You'll see in just a moment. There he is.
Good evening. This is Tom, KB4HQA, with the HQA Radio Sunday Live Show for August 4th, 2013. I don't think there's anybody watching right now. We had a problem with Ustream, and we had to switch over to a different account, and now we're starting 2 hours late.
So Tom never pretended that he was a broadcaster. A ham. A ham who had the ambition to do these kinds of programs and did them as well as he could. The information, once again, this is something I don't think that you guys care that much about. You don't really care if somebody's being a professional broadcaster. You're more interested in the information that can be imparted. I try to do both, be somewhat professional and give you good information. Tom just was all about the information.
Browser, so we'll let you check that out in a little bit. But first of all, we're going to go over a couple of the HTs. Now, if you're a brand new ham and you want to get an HT.
So I don't know if you've ever watched the program. Hopefully you have. We're going to miss Tom. 73, old man. All right. Let's get back down to Dayton. Who am I talking to?
My name is Bill Harrison with Hardened Power Systems.
Got a call sign, Bill?
KK4JPT.
That should be included, you know, whenever you're talking to people.
Yes, I know. I know. I know it should.
Okay. I've come across your stuff on the website, and I was pretty intrigued. What is Hardened Power Systems?
Well, just a few years ago, it was me in the garage for a couple different reasons, tinkering with alternate power, started to get challenged by some friends. You know, how small can you make something? Because they loved what I was making, but it was too expensive. So they'd say, well, I can spend X, and I'd start shrinking things down. I'm a CAD guy, manufacturing engineer type, so by the time I got everything as small as I could make them, we fit them in an ammo can.
These things we're talking about, these are power supplies.
They are, but it's an inverter and a solar controller and buck converters. And, I mean, you can plug phones into it, CPAP. You're not going to plug a fridge into it, but definitely any kind of electronics or communication devices. A lot of ham radio guys are customers.
So pretty much emergency power supplies.
Mostly, at least that's what we thought. But now there's a lot of folks that just purely just run their radios. They'll treat it like a UPS. Run it 24/7, have their gear plugged into it, and they know it's charged, and if they lose the power, they know they're going to keep on running.
This one that I'm looking at here, what makes this the big deal?
It's pretty much our original offering. It's been improved over the last few years, but it's called a Juice Box R2, and it's like we were just talking about. It's got the inverter, power supply, batteries, plug it into the wall and charge it, plug it into a solar panel and charge it. One of the neat things, it's a U.S. Ammo can. You close that lid, and it is absolutely waterproof. You know, we've got people that use them in farm trucks and in open fishing boats. Definitely are out in the weather is no problem.
What kind of life do you get from it? What can it support?
Well, it's a total of 24 amp hours, and the inverter is 450 watts nominal, not surge, 450 constant. You could run a small fridge. I wouldn't suggest it. A lot of people want to. That's not the thing. If you think laptops and ham radios and cell phones and LED lights, you're right down the middle of what the juice box is designed for.
And what does it sell for?
This is a $540 machine without a solar panel. And very competitive. You know, we really definitely, our best customers are the people who have already looked all over the place.
What kind of batteries inside?
It's an AGM, so absorbed glass mat. It's not new technology, but it's very solid. It's they were invented for jet fighters so they could fly upside down. Don't leak. You don't maintain them. You don't do anything to it.
Don't gas.
They don't outgas. Same stuff in like your grandmother's scooter or emergency lighting or whatever. Very solid. About 500 charge cycles typically, and you can replace them without tools in the field. There, it's RBC4 is the standard size. Easy to find.
Okay, you got another cute toy that you have just come up with recently.
Yes.
You can pick that up and show me.
The DHAP has been, was launched in November of last year, and it's been good to us. This is a digital access point that is intended purely for use with D-Star and the DV dongle. As long as the user supplies the dongle, then they can open this machine up like this. They can nest their dongle in place, charge it up, power it up, use a wireless or plug into the Ethernet. Basically, everything on the Raspberry Pi computer, which is inside, has been remoted to the exterior.
Okay, so this starts with the deal that a Raspberry Pi plus a DVAT can make an access point for D-Star. You still need a D-Star radio.
You still need a D-Star radio, but these are a riot. We've got several in the shop, and I can walk from my shop to the house with an ID51 on my belt. And absolutely, I mean, anybody who knows D-Star knows this, but you're talking globally, you know, 2 meter, very easily. And the range, you know, they'll claim it's a bit more, but we really do see 300-400 feet pretty easily.
Okay, and you need a Wi-Fi connection for that to get to the internet.
Well, you need a connection. It can be this Wi-Fi, or it can be a direct RJ45 into like a router.
Okay, you need an internet connection.
Yep, absolutely.
So if you want to be weighed out in the field, you need like a phone or something that can be a Wi-Fi hotspot.
Although a D-Star guy is probably yelling at his screen right now. You could still run Simplex. Two men with these machines within a range of one another, you don't need internet, and you can still be digital. So strictly speaking, you could still communicate without the internet, but in practical terms, you and me, yeah, it's an internet device.
Okay, and what does this go for?
This is $290, complete with the DHEP and the SD card already imaged. We do sell a version for $225 that does not include the Pi or the SD card.
Okay, and you bring your own DVAP device?
Yes, you do.
Does it work with any of the other hotspot devices, or are you pretty much locked into the DVAP?
You know, on an R&D standpoint, we kicked that around a lot, and we just settled on D-Star, I think correctly, kind of banking on ICOM's influence, just the way that D-Star operates, which is beautiful. Although the learning curve is steep, once you're there, it's fabulous. So we're hoping to see that continued growth. And honestly, myself, I really want to see some of the younger digital screen kids get into ham radio. And I'll tell you, one way that you can really hook them is with something like this. Because this is not a whole backyard full of antennas. They get it. They get the Wi-Fi, the hotspot, all that. And once they realize that they're talking to somebody in Tokyo over a 5-watt handheld, they get pretty excited. I like that a lot.
Are the DMR Moto Turbo folks after you to do something for them?
Not that I'm aware of.
Not yet.
Although we have a really hard time saying no when people have good ideas. Most are good ideas. Come from customers.
So if they had a device like the DVAP, what I don't know whether they do or not, it could go in there.
Depending on its physical dimensions and the specifications, the software it needed. Yeah, the beauty of the Raspberry Pi, it's a computer. You know, program it.
Okay, this is battery operated.
It is. It uses a 2-amp-hour nickel metal hydride battery pack. It's rechargeable. You can plug it in right here, charge it up. You can also run the system just by plugging a USB power supply into the USB power port.
When I was looking at it on the website, I noticed nickel metal hydride, and I was wondering why you chose that over lithium ion.
I actually have like a list of reasons.
And I'm not criticizing, I'm educating.
No, not at all, yeah. Lithium ion is awesome. In fact, our highest end juice boxes use lithium ferrophosphate, which is a much more stable, non-toxic, somewhat more expensive version of a lithium battery. But there's a couple of things. Lithium ion, you start getting into certain battery sizes, you cannot travel with them easily. You can be arguing with a TSA gentleman about why it's really okay for you to take this on an airplane. That's one of the reasons we engrave nickel metal hydride on the outside of our gear, so that argument doesn't happen. It's true that lithium ion has slightly longer cycle times, at least anticipated, predicted cycle times. Nickel metal hydride, frankly, is tougher. You can kick it around more. Temperature extremes, you can abuse it a little bit more. Lithium ion, you know, it's true you don't have a memory effect as long as you charge it 3-4 times in the very beginning, full to empty. Nickel metal hydride is not that fussy. It's a little workhorse. It's maybe a little less expensive. It's easier to charge. It's not as complex of a charging algorithm. It's easier for us to offer solar capabilities because the charging algorithm is simpler with nickel metal hydride. We've got a prototype repeater here that has a built-in solar controller, and we couldn't do that if we were running lithium ion.
A prototype repeater. Tell me about that.
It didn't exist a week ago. It is, we're calling it the Echo One. It uses the Argent Data Systems Simplex repeater and an internal solar controller, internal battery, a shock-mounted system for the handheld radio of your choice, a different enclosure and mounting scheme. Definitely tool-free. It's meant to be set down or set up. The antenna will swivel.
This is not waterproof, but it's tough.
Yeah, we would very comfortably call it hardened. You know, and the main reason you should,
because that's kind of the name of your company.
Amen, amen. I just got tired of breaking things just by using them. But things like this, which really are quite simple, but it's just a bungee shock mount. And there's more than enough room for that radio to travel if the machine takes a hit.
What's the radio in there?
This is just a Baofeng. You know, we deliberately use what would you want to call that? I don't want to call it the Chevette. It's the cheap radio.
Oh,
yeah, and it's a great radio for what it is. You know, as long as you can figure out how to run it, these radios are wide open. I mean, they'll basically operate on just about anything as far as bands and so forth.
Okay, so another battery-operated deal.
It is, and it also has got a built-in solar controller. You know, the idea here really is to try to fill that gap between, at least a gap that we think is there, between a couple of guys talking on their radios and the local ham club's repeater on a hilltop. With something like this, spend a few $100, set it up, and maybe you and a half a dozen of your ham buddies that are within a 5-mile radius of one another, all of a sudden you're talking.
So you said it's Argent Simplex repeater.
Yeah, Argent Data Systems makes the Simplex repeater that we're using internally. The idea here is that the ham guy goes out. He gets this, because there's a couple different versions. He uses a handheld radio. I'm guessing he probably already has sitting around the shack. But in any event, he picks a 5-watt handheld, and he just slips them in and plugs them into one another, programs the radio to cooperate with the Argent, and he's on the air.
This is not a crossband repeater. This is I talk, and it records me, and then it sends me back out.
It is. And there is a delay, and there's the constituent issues with that. There's also some benefits. You know, it's voicemail. You know, you can leave messages. You can broadcast messages. You could use it for a fox hunt. There's some flexibility built in that's pretty cool. And out of the ones we looked at, and I'm not knocking any of them because there's a lot of good stuff out there, but the Argent was the most highly regarded.
So this product is not for sale yet? It's still beta?
It is not for sale. Our supply chain's filling. You know, we know how we're going to do, what we're going to do. We're through with testing. I guess I would encourage people to look at the website.
Do you have a price set, I guess, for it? You must know about what you want.
Definitely under $300. One of the things, you know, since we're designing our own stuff, building our own stuff, and selling our own stuff, we can have a pretty tight margin, and everybody's happy. It's not that big of a deal. It makes it hard for us to have wholesale and retail relationships, because there just isn't room for some of the markups that you commonly see. But that's okay. You know, so far we don't advertise. We just try to build nice stuff, and we've got great customers that tend to like our stuff and tell people about it. And that's
so all your sales are off your website.
Almost all. You know, obviously an event like this is very special to us. You know, this is a big deal. So there's going to be some sales here that have nothing to do with the website. But yeah, probably.
But no dealers, none of the ham stores.
We have a couple. There's an outfit called OCRR. Gigaparts actually carries our juice boxes. We've got some that are out there. It's just they almost have to be friends because the markup is not really that much. You know, we can't pay. I suppose we could pay more, but the easy thing to say is that we've never caught up. So you know, until we're at a point where we need more sales and we're looking for stuff, it's kind of hard to discount. You know, we don't really necessarily need help selling them. We need help building them. That's our problem right now.
We've moved out of your garage?
Yes, moved out of the garage into a larger building, and then 3 months ago finished the next larger building, which is next door, and it's connected. And for us, it's great. I mean, it's so nice to have room for more equipment and more people. It's a blessing.
So it's a real business now.
It is. Oh, yeah. We joke about that it's, you know, Middle Tennessee in my backyard. But, yeah, oh, yeah, it's a big business. It's a real business. It's growing.
Who do you aim at as customers? Hams, obviously, but who else?
Hams are a big one. We have a surprising number, actually, of military and first responder customers. We've got some products that we haven't talked about here that are like armored battery systems that are kind of neat. Waterproof, crush-proof, like literally crush-proof, drive over them with a car type armored battery. So Joint Special Operations Command has been a good customer along those lines. Our only deal with them is we don't sell anything to them that we can't sell to the public. So it's pretty cool for us, you know, because you guys can get the same stuff that like a recon team is using for ballistic computers and GPS and stuff. That's our Weevolt, and it's a miniature armored battery that's charged with a solar panel.
Communication with you guys, what's the best way?
The website definitely is the most reliable and the fastest. That's portableuniversalpower.com. There's email addresses on the site. My name is Bill Harrison. My email address is bill@portableuniversalpower.com. If you try to reach us, myself or Julie, with the same address, one of us will respond just as quick as we can. You know, if we've struggled with anything, it's just growth. It's a great problem to have. It's just we're trying not to make it our customer's problem. We're just trying to not grow too quickly.
Are you hiring?
We are, yes. Bench Tech, somebody in Middle Tennessee who loves smoke and solder, likes ham radio. We don't even necessarily need somebody with a whole lot of training. Most of what we do is a little unusual. It's almost easier to teach somebody from scratch than to unlearn some things. But yes, we are. Same email, same address. I'd love to hear from somebody.
Thanks very much.
Absolutely. Thank you. Appreciate the time.
So tell me who you are.
Okay. My name is Al, and I'm an NN4ZZ.
And what's your product?
I sell products that are designed to help amateur operators work on their towers and antennas from the ground without having to climb ladders. So this product here is called the TiltPlate, and this is for Yagi antennas, and it lets you operate or work on your Yagi antenna at the ground level.
Yeah, so I think this is for a tilt-over tower? Or
yeah, this is for tilt-over, typically tilt-over crank-up type towers.
So the problem is you tilt over your tower and your antenna slams into the ground.
Exactly. The tips of the elements hit the ground, so you really end up on a 16 or 18-foot ladder trying to work on the antenna or the rotator. And this product lets you actually tilt the tower all the way to the ground so that everything is down at chest level.
And as you're aiming toward the ground, it's flattening out the antenna.
Exactly. I can show you that here. So what you're seeing here is this represents the mast of your tower, and this is the tilt plate that bolts onto your mast. This represents the boom of your antenna, and this represents your elements. Of course, your boom and elements would be much longer, and the boom would be longer as well. So when you're in the upright position, everything is as normal. As you tilt the tower over, what you're going to see at about this point here is that you'll notice that the movable plate with the boom on it is starting to move. So that now as your tower comes completely horizontal, you'll notice that the elements of the antenna are also parallel to the ground. So now you've got the tower, the boom, and the elements all close to the ground. You can get to every part of your antenna, including the rotator on your tower and all parts of your tower.
Okay, so this has added some stuff, and it doesn't, what is it, aluminum? Is it fairly lightweight, or are we adding a big wind and weight load?
Okay, so but what you're basically adding is about 30 pounds of weight for this standard model. As far as a wind load addition, this basically replaces your boom mast plate. So what you're doing is you're getting about a net gain of about 1 square foot of wind load and about 30 pounds of vertical weight. So it's not a whole lot. And again, this is the medium size model, our most popular model. We make a smaller model for lighter antennas and a larger one for the very heavy antennas up to 250 pounds.
What do people need to be concerned about in particular if they're going to add this to their antenna system? Anything to worry about?
Nothing in particular to worry about. What we find is that a lot of people with the large antennas will actually put the plate on the tower first, then mount the boom and build the antenna right on here. So what that allows you to do is a person can build it completely on their own. You don't need help. You don't have to lift a 200 or 150 pound antenna. So you can actually build it right there on the ground.
Okay. So I'm thinking of strength. Is when you put this system onto your antenna system, are you compromising strength in any way?
I would say not. And in fact, I've got a link on my website that will show an installation where this tilt plate was mounted on a tower in Colorado that was hit by a tornado. The tower was completely destroyed and twisted. The antenna was destroyed. The only salvageable part on the whole assembly was the tilt plate. So it's very robustly built.
Okay, so you're not guaranteeing it will survive a tornado, but you've got an example of one that
that's
did.
That's right, that's right.
And your lawyer is going to thank me for saying that.
And also, I will say that because we know people put expensive antennas on these, we wanted to be sure that our product would not be the single point of failure. So we want to make it very robust. It's a half-inch thick aluminum. All the bearings are very heavy-duty. The shaft is aluminum. All the hardware is stainless steel. We have four U-bolts holding the mast, which is as much or more than most vendors give you, so you won't have any problem with slippage. We have four U-bolts for the boom, and we have U-bolts holes drilled to support booms from one inch up to 3 inches.
How much does this product go for? What's
This model here is $750. We have a larger model that's $895 and a smaller model that's $700.
Okay, what typical beams will each of those support?
So we support anything from a compact three-element tri-bander all the way up to the largest antennas like the Dream Beam 42, which is a 250-pound stepper antenna. So we support the whole range.
Nothing is too big?
Not yet. And all the specs are on our website.
How about that 40-meter Mach Sun I saw over there?
We could do that too.
All right, and you got a couple other products quickly for other style antennas?
We have a product for the hex beams. It's called the hex lock. What this allows you to do is you mount your hex beam right up above the lock, and as you're tilting the tower over with the hex beam, this will unlock, and you can actually rotate the hex beam up so you can also work on that from the ground level. And then it locks again in the vertical position. So that's for the hex beams. It adds about 11 or 12 pounds to the weight total. This product is what we call the quad lock. It's for a cubical quad antenna. Over on this side, you can see where the U-bolts hold the spreaders for a quad. So you have one of these locks for each element in your quad. I've got a three-element quad. We've got a customer in Florida that's got a four-element quad. And you have one of these devices for each element. In the upright position, this lock prevents the element from rotating on the boom. As you tilt the tower over, the lock unlocks. And when the tower gets tilted over and the quad's about to hit the ground, you grab the end of it and you rotate each element flat so you have now three or four elements pancaked together and you can bring the entire tower down to ground level. So we had a customer that single-handedly built his own four-element quad, five-band, and he built it without ever having to get off the ground.
So I'm glad I was finally able to get that product on the program. A little bit late. We did it in Orlando a year ago, and I've aced Jeff out of one of his interviews and did it myself, but it's there. Seems like an interesting product. We don't endorse the products that we show. I've never tried either one of them. They're just presented there for your enlightenment. This is what I was aiming to do when I went to Dayton this year, which is to visit some of the smaller manufacturers. Hardened Power started in a garage. They're not in a garage anymore. I suspect that the tilt plate is still being done in a garage or basement or, you know, workshop someplace. But I don't think he's got the tilt plate manufacturing company behind him. So that's what we're aiming to do. And we've got a couple more like that. Didn't get to everybody that I would have liked to get to. I mean, Dayton is huge. There's an awful lot of people there. But that was the goal this year and probably going forward to find the folks that you may not have heard about, at least some of you may not have heard about. So that inside information that I was going to show you and talk about, I haven't spent very much time talking about individual contributors. A lot of other shows do that. They list just about everybody who's made a contribution. And a lot of people have made contributions to keep Ham Radio Now going, and I appreciate it very, very much. People that stop by hamradionow.tv, Arvin is prodding me to say this again, and click the buttons, clicked Arvin's icon, and made a contribution using PayPal or credit card. I think we're at about 600 individual people that have done that, so that's been very nice. I've collected some of the folks that have made contributions and made comments. Most of these are from folks that have made comments along with the contributions. There's a little box where you can say a few things, so thought I would show you a few of those. Jimmy Cleveland, KD0HXG from Lynn, Missouri, says, keep on broadcasting. Okay, Jimmy, we're going to try. Jim Scheidler, W5JCS. Jim makes a lot of comments, both direct and email on YouTube and on the Yahoo news group, or the Yahoo group that I've started for Ham Radio Now. If you haven't joined that, it's not a busy group. It won't flood your inbox, and you can always check a little checkbox that says, just send me the special announcements. And when I put a new episode up, that's one of the first places that I go. The very first place that will let you know that something is up there is if you subscribe to the YouTube channel, youtube.com/hamradionow. Can I dial that up? Yeah, there it is. I haven't done my channel art. This is the way the page looks to me, not to you, the user. This is what it looks like to you. Just that big blank thing up there. This is what it keeps reminding me. I should add some art. I'll get around to that sooner or later. You do at least get to see my little logo there. And as we record this, the Friday Night BS, 324 views. Collins Collectors, 521. So those are building up. Hijinks did real well. Over 2,000 so far. So that's moving along pretty well. But that's not what I wanted to show you. I wanted to show you the Yahoo group. So I've got a little bit better artwork up there with the Yahoo group. And there's all my other... I'm subscribed to a lot of different Yahoo groups. So this is what it looks like. It's not a difficult group to join. It's not moderated right now. It won't be moderated until it turns out to have an issue, a problem. So far, there's been no spam up there. Now that I mention it, probably we'll get some. And we'll just change it to moderated, and it'll take a little longer for things to come and go. But you can join at will. And once again, if you do that, you'll have a button that you can push that says you're only going to get the announcements that I put up there. So when I make something like this, an announcement like that, and if people were to reply to it, and pretty much nobody does, you'd only get my original announcement. So again, Jim Scheidler. Hope I'm pronouncing your last name right, Jim. W5JCS, Stillwater, Oklahoma. It was watching episode 150. That's the hijinks, ham hijinks and the straight key night, straight key century club. At 12 minutes into the video, he stopped to feed the pig. Well, Jim has fed the pig many times. Thank you, Jim. Great presentation. You like that one. Don Gover, KC9ZMY, Chicago, Illinois. My old hometown. Keep up the good work, Gary. I appreciate all the work you put into each video, and yeah, pretty much a lot of work. Eric Boyle, N0YET, Salina, Kansas. My third time feeding the pig. Enjoyed the Joe Ham interview. These are getting older, so the current stuff is not part of these. Your stuff is getting better, but you still need to stop taking your mic away from the subjects. Okay, Eric, I understand a lot of people have said that. I tend to interrupt people, but I call that a lively conversation. You can't let just, because these are typically not edited, so you can't let people just go on and on and on. There are times when I'm watching on playback, and I kind of wish they'd gone on, because it seems like they were making a point and I never, or didn't really let them get to that particular point or get far enough along in it. But, it's doing that on the fly. It takes a certain amount of experience and talent, and I'm gaining the experience. Don't know about the talent. But I'm also trying to keep conversations moving. And I find that if I don't do that interrupting thing, then people just tend to move on and on and on, and then I start wishing I had interrupted earlier. So that's the deal on that. Brian O'Donnell, VA3, BCO, Ontario, Canada. As a new ham, your videos are extremely helpful. Thank you very much for the great content. You're welcome. Don, been there. Where am I? Don Batts, WE3UPJ, Kalamazoo, Michigan. Go to Tapper. That's my goal. Before I do another Ham Radio Now episode after this one, I will spend some time putting things together for, I think we'll do Kickstarter. I like the all or nothing thing of Kickstarter. It gives both of us, you and me, the audience and me, the incentive to keep things going by the deadline. And the deadline is probably going to be the end of July. So we got August to prepare for getting out there. And the Tapper conference is at the very beginning of September, the weekend after Labor Day. So need that much time to figure out, yes, we're going to go. Okay, we'll put things together, buy some materials, and get going. So that Kickstarter will run from as soon as Kickstarter lets me, which is probably going to be about the 1st of July, assuming they accept it, and I expect that they will, because it's the same as the one we did before. Unless they've got some deal about you can't do the same thing over again, and I've never seen them say anything about that. So I'm expecting we'll be okay. Probably run during the month of July, so that'll be your opportunity. We'll try to go to Tapper. David Wright, WNRIT, Brookfield, Wisconsin. Enjoy your shows. Much more informative than Ham Nation. Yeah, well, okay. It's a competition, I guess. Keep up the great work. From Dave, WNRIT. Craig Moody, K1CHM, Westerly, Rhode Island. I need Rhode Island for my work all states. No, I don't really, but a lot of you people do, I'm sure. I started at the beginning. I'm up to episode 10. Well, he said this on the 13th, well, that's just a couple days ago. He's got a ways to go. I think I sent him back email saying I was going to mention his name on one of these episodes, so he'd have to watch. So maybe he's started watching toward the end now. I don't know. Otherwise, it's going to be a while before you get up to seeing yourself mentioned on television here, Craig. Everything is of great value to me. Oh, it reminds me of the Gene Shepherd radio show. Thanks. Gene's call was, I think, K2ORS. Did a program on WOR. He did the Christmas Story movie about Ralphie and his BB gun. So, and he talked about ham radio on his show. He wasn't one of those broadcasters that never mentioned ham radio, even though he was a ham. I didn't talk about it all the time, but we talked about it once in a while. Jeff Citizen, Jeff, I'm going to screw up your last name. KD0UAG. Jeff asked if he could use the Field Day video. He sent email asking. Actually, he was going to buy it, and I said, it's online. You can have it for free. And in fact, I sent him an MP4 of it, so he wouldn't have to Jeep YouTube to get it downloaded. Thank you very much for the use of the videos. They'll be a great addition to our field day activities. They're going to, like a lot of clubs do, play the last big field day, which was actually the first documentary program that I put together. And I shot it way back in 2004. Okay, nothing from the show is... It's going to be there, except me promoting the DVD, which you don't really need to buy anymore. I shot it way back in 2004 and didn't get around to editing it until 2011. But doing that allowed me to have some historical perspective. The last big field day is the last time there was a station entered in the category 51A. Were they 51 or 50? They changed partway through when they did their count. I think that they thought they were going to be 51A, and they had to knock it down to 50 once they did a final count. Because when you're running that many transmitters, it can be difficult to know just how many you've got on the air. And the end of the documentary explains why they don't do that anymore, because the ARL changed their rules. It also explains how they got to 51 or 50 transmitters. And I think I'll just leave that as a teaser. You can now go to the video and watch it. It is Ham Radio Now, episode 79. Probably a little bit too late for you to decide that you want to do that as part of your club meeting. But that's what Jeff is planning on doing, or maybe has already done with his radio club. And a lot of other clubs have done that. So it's a good tradition every year. Get everybody ginned up and say, we've got to win, and maybe we can find a way to get to 50 transmitters. Again, you don't want to do that. The league, what they did after this, not exactly a competition to get all those transmitters up, because only a few clubs were doing it, they cut off your bonus points after 20 transmitters. So you couldn't get more, that extra 100 points per transmitter after 20. And they also said, and they've always sort of had this in the rules, at least for a long time, that the transmitters all have to be capable of being on the air at the same time, simultaneous. And they, I think, reinforced that concept. And if you watch the last big field day, you'll see that they weren't necessarily all on the air at the same time. I'll give you that much of a clue. Okay, so we saw some of the comments from people who have been watching. I wanted to give you a little bit of an update on how Ham Radio Now is doing. So let me dig into the Ham Radio Now secret financial information. And this is from my QuickBooks. I use QuickBooks to keep all my records. And this is what has happened so far. This box, this one here, can you see it okay? Let me point it out there and we'll switch back to it. That box is this year, January through, well, it says December, but it just, you know, it means now because there's nothing in there after today for 2014. And where we're at is $4,133.31. 331 individual contributions. That doesn't mean 331 individual people made contributions, because even just this year, some people have made multiple contributions. And I've got a handful of people, big handful of people, you know, a dozen or so, that put in something every month, including a few folks that put in $25 every month. Every month. I'm not asking you to do that. I'm just proud that there are some folks that are doing that. So 331 contributions so far. The average contribution, if you look over there in the right-hand column, that is $12.49. And I'm asking for $10 a year. I'd like to get it from 10,000 AMs. Yeah, that figure, I believe, is a little bit out of reach. But you know, we're averaging a little bit more than that, but from a far smaller number of people so far. The other box, this one here, can I make it move a little bit so you can see where it is? Yeah, there we go. Is last year to the same time. 227 individual contributions, $3,777.17. A little bit higher average contribution, a little more than a buck per contribution more. But with this year, a lot more people, and it totaled up to a few hundred dollars more. So that's the way things look right now. Actually, there's a few more contributions that I haven't put in the totals yet. I'm going to show you the PayPal page with the current cluster of contributions. And I'm going to block out the names on that because I don't think it's fair to show you what each individual person is contributing. That's not information that I have told people I was going to share. So this is what the PayPal page looks like. And again, I'm blocking out the column that shows people's names, but you get the you can get the idea of how things go day to day. June 15th, yesterday, as I'm recording this, 3 contributions. June 14th, 2. That doesn't look too good. June 13th, Friday the 13th, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that looked pretty good. That was before the episode with Bill and me. So yeah, maybe that's why things have slowed down. The 12th, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's see. What did this guy say? I enjoy most of the programs. You know, I really don't expect anybody to love all of them. Some of you do. Some of you, you just, every time I put out a program, that was a great program, Gary. I really loved it, which is fine. You can please all the people some of the time, some of the people all the time, but not all, you know, how that goes. Where were we? Well, I think we've gone far enough in that list. So that's a little bit of inside Ham Radio Now and where the finances are, for those of you that care. And for those of you that really care, once again, Arvin is sitting back there reminding me, as he always does, to point you to the website, hamradionow.tv. Let me see what that looks like, as long as I'm showing you stuff. And when we say click on Arvin's icon, that's this thing right over here. And you click on that, it takes you to this ugly-looking page where you can figure out how much you want to contribute. And yes, there are more than a handful. a big handful of people that have contributed at the $100 level. Or this option, I guess I need to change it from being a new option because it's not that new anymore. But you can decide how much you want to put in. I kind of stopped it at $25 a month. I'd feel guilty about taking more than that from somebody every month. And you can, I'm mentioning putting your call sign in comments because there's no field in the PayPal page for a call sign. You can type about as much as you want in here. It's going to be ugly because the box doesn't open up and you kind of scroll off the end. It's kind of like some teletype programs worked. Your stuff, you see what you're typing, but you don't see what you typed after the first 10 or 15 characters or so. But you can put in as much as you want. There's another spot in the PayPal page. There's a spot for instructions to the vendor. And most of you don't need to give me any instructions. There's really nothing to do. You're sending me some money and you watch online. I'm not mailing you anything. But you can also type in there and I'll see those. And that gives you a box where you can see what you're saying. Or you can send me email, kn4aq@arvn.tv. Or you can get on the Yahoo site, or you can make comments on the YouTube pages underneath YouTube. A lot of people do that. Or on qrz.com when I get an episode announcement up there. It's just a mess. There's stuff every place. But the important thing is to go here and punch a button. Now, somebody told me don't feel guilty. Don't feel awkward or hesitant about asking for money. The programs are worthwhile. So here I am being very forward about it. Send me money. Right, Arvin? Okay, Arvin says good. Let's wrap this puppy up. Again, it's going to be a while probably now, a week or so, maybe more. I do have more stuff from Dayton. There'll be more programs coming. Several more folks who've made stuff, who sell stuff and want to show it to you. And then that robotics thing with the kids. So that'll be coming up. But I've got to do the Kickstarter because it takes a week or so before they approve it, assuming that they do. And if they don't, for some reason, I've got to go to Plan B. So that's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Thanks for watching. Appreciate it. 73, everybody. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.